started to get people oriented to what I'm talking about by reading a little bit from the introduction to the book. So the book starts, the introduction starts with an epigraph written by she writes, "We as Native Hawaiians must continue to unveil the knowledge of our ancestors. Let us interpret for ourselves who our ancestors are, how they thought, and why they made certain decisions. In the process, we treat them with honor, dignity, love, and respect." The main purpose of this book is to further the project of mapping Kanaka Hawaii intellectual history. How can we know that our ancestors were, are intellectual beings, and know more specifically in whose path we are now following? Fortunately, our ancestors took great pains to write down our moʻolelo, lyric, epic, and other forms of poetry, political and economic analyses of their times, interpretations of their ancestors' philosophies, histories, and oral literatures, and so on. As we read what they wrote, which is overwhelmingly in their native language, Aloha Hawaii, we inevitably gain an appreciation of the depth of their thought and their artistic genius. As Pualani Kanahele articulates in the epigraph, when we do this work of interpretation, we honor and respect our ancestors. We are also then able to consciously continue distinctive Kanaka thought and intellectual production. This book then mainly consists of reading the works of our ancestors, concentrating on the writing careers of two men. The first, Joseph Mokuʻōhai Poepoe, was a school teacher from Kalawao, who lived his adult life on Oʻahu and contributed a wide variety of writing to Hawaiian language newspapers. He was a strong advocate for the newspapers and the native language. He published between about 1856 and 1883. The second is Joseph Mokuʻōhai Poepoe, who was an attorney, writer, editor, and politician from Kahala, Hawaii, who also lived his adult life in the capital of Honolulu. He published in the Hawaiian language newspapers, starting with translations of European tales from about 1878 to 1913. Both of the authors studied in this book were committed to recording and interpreting not only the wisdom of their ancestors, but also their own political and cultural circumstances. They needed to set down in print their engagement with the intellectual traditions of their ancestors, of previous eras, and they needed to analyze their world, and thereby not only describe what intellectual, Hawaiian intellectual life is or was, but to live it. Our intellectual engagement is part of our specifically Hawaiian ontology, our way of being in the world. This ontology is not and has never been static, but is constantly formed in relation to our aina and our ancestors. The two very different men in this study wrote within different contexts. Nevertheless, I found some similarities in their motivations for writing and publishing and commonalities in their philosophies. First is a deeply ingrained commitment to our people and land, aloha aina. Second, acceptance of the kuleana to teach through writing and publishing. And third, an ethic and orientation to the world I'm calling moʻokuʻāhau consciousness. And I'll now briefly describe aloha aina and moʻokuʻāhau consciousness. Aloha aina is a central ideology for our ancestors that is striking in the works of both Kanahulu and Poepoe. It is a complex concept that includes recognizing that we are an integral part of the aina and the aina is an part of that is a regenerated belief in our ancestors' cosmogonies, which include moʻolelo, moʻokuʻāhau, which is genealogies, and melekoʻi honua, the genealogical chants, that tell us that the earth is papahana moku, the expanse of the sky is wakea, and that among their children and descendants are the kalahaloa and his younger brother haloa, the first human being. Within this idea of aloha aina is the concept of kinolelo, are multiple physical bodies of spirits. Such spirits may include that of individual humans, aumakua, our ancestors whose spirits were transformed into specific animals or elements, and akua, deities or other spirits who may manifest in animals, plants, or elements such as rain, rainbows, clouds, volcanic fires, and so on. Our familial relationships to these views are part of our feeling and our ethic of Ohana. Ohana, moreover, is an important political concept. It includes the kuleana to malama of care for Ohana. Kuleana encompasses right, authority, and responsibility, and suggests a familial relationship. Throughout this book, we see the ways that our intellectual kupuna of the 19th and early 20th centuries used moʻokuʻāwa consciousness to perpetuate our language, moʻolelo, mele, and so on. They positioned themselves within the moʻokuʻāwa, the genealogy of our Lāhui. That is, they greatly valued the narrative and poetic traditions of their kupuna, and they used their talents to record them for their descendants. In the 21st century, we are who they foresaw, descendants whose primary language is now that of the colonizer, but who need and are benefiting from their efforts to write in Hawaiian. Many of us are similarly building on their foundations, or as Larry Kuhnoi Kimura put it, relaying the large stones of the foundation in order to have a Kanaka house in which we and our descendants can live. Now I'd like to introduce you to Joseph Poepoe. Again, I'll read a little bit. That is one. So, Joseph Mokuʻōhai Poepoe was born in Honomakaʻu, Kohala, on the island of Hawaiʻi in March 1852. His mother's name was Kiabahiku, and his father was G.W. Poepoe, also known as G.W. Kahiolo, a teacher and an assistant principal. Kahiolo was the author of the first full-length Hawaiian moʻolelo published in the newspapers, in moʻolelo no kamakua. By the time that Poepoe was of school age, the family had moved to the capital of Honolulu on Oʻahu. He attended public schools in Kalihi and Kalua in Ewa, and afterward he attended Kaheiona, now the Royal School, which probably was right around here somewhere at that time. And that, in an earlier era, was called the Kula Aliʻi and had educated the Moʻi and other Aliʻi. He completed his secondary school education at Aʻi Mānoa Roman Catholic School, now called St. Louis. He was a native Hawaiian speaker, an accomplished speaker and writer in English, and he also knew French, Latin, and Hebrew. Following his secondary education, Poepoe returned to Kohala, where he worked as a school teacher, and established the first school that taught English there. Apparently unsatisfied with teaching as a career, he began his study of law in Kohala. He returned to Honolulu to further his study of law, and he studied with W.R. Castle, Sanford Dole, and the firm Davidson and Lukel. He became an attorney licensed to practice in all Hawaiian courts. And around the same time that he began practicing law, he also began to publish a newspaper. And these simultaneous careers started in the late 1870s while Moʻi Kalako was in office. So Poepoe's first publications were translations of moʻolelo in 1878 in a paper called Ko Hawaiʻi Kai Aina. In 1883, he began his work as an editor at Hokulo Ke Kai. So Hokulo Ke Kai was never filmed because it was a monthly publication, so it didn't fit the category of what citing the poem. But luckily you have most of it there. So anyway, this monthly publication was filled with moʻolelo, both from the Hawaiian oral tradition and translated from English and perhaps other languages. It also featured regular columns. And although the columns are unsigned, I think it's reasonable to attribute the legal writing in here to the attorney editor Poepoe. He wrote two of these. One was called simply Kekanabai, or the Law, and the other was called Nakumumua, o Kekanabai, or the Origins of Law. In 1884, in this paper, he wrote an essay called O Kapalelo Hea, Kapalelo Kanabai. So, which would be the language of the law? Poepoe argues in this essay that the law that was passed in 1864 states that, this is a quote from the English version of the law, which also we have two versions. Whenever there exists a radical and irreconcilable difference between the English and Hawaiian versions of the laws of the kingdom, the English version shall be binding. He considered that to be, he wrote, pono ole, or unfair. He points out that many, or unpono, I guess is better, points out that many legislators are kanaka who do not know